Welcome to a special on the road edition of Full Steam Ahead, a podcast about Purdue. We are recording from beautiful Alexander Field where the rain is here, but we're hoping to get a little bit of a game in today, but that's neither here nor there. It is my privilege to welcome into the podcast Purdue alums and the voices of Purdue baseball, Drew and Kyle Charters. Gentlemen, welcome to the podcast. How are you guys doing?
Good. Thanks for having us.
Doing excellent. Hoping to play baseball tonight. You know, baseball in the Midwest, this is sort of how it goes, but hopefully we'll play a little bit.
Yeah, let's hope so. Well, thank you guys so much for joining the podcast. I've been looking forward to talking to you guys for a while and just talk some Purdue baseball and, of course, your journey through Purdue and just your love for Purdue as well. Let's just kind of start with some brief introductions. We'll start with you, Drew.
Sure.
Just kind of tell us about yourself. Obviously, you guys are both from the same spot, but just kind of talk about where you guys grew up and then how you made your way to Purdue.
Yeah, we grew up here in West Lafayette. Went to Harrison High School, local school here in Tippecanoe County. I've stuck around my entire life. Kyle, he'll tell you, left for a little while. But I currently live right down the street from my childhood home, went to Purdue. I was a probation officer right out of college. Switched gears for a little while, met my wife, switched gears for a little while, and now I run a replacement window company and do the baseball gig on the side.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Cool. How about you, Kyle?
So it's the same story, obviously. We grew up in the same house, went to Harrison, graduated from there in 97. He was a few years behind me, so in 2000. Graduated from Purdue in 2001, a telecommunications major. So I actually did then leave town, went to Marion, did some radio news in the morning, came back, worked at Golden Black Illustrated, covered Purdue football and women's basketball, mainly as a writer, but also a podcaster, I guess, and did some radio on the side, including... Then in 2004, that's when I started as a Purdue baseball play-by-play. Drew joined probably five or so years later.
My first part-time, you had me fill in 2007 for the first time. My first full-time was 2008.
Awesome, cool.
So, yeah, so we've been doing that. We had a morning radio show together, unfortunately, that was silenced by COVID, which was really fun, because we, I think, have a certain chemistry where I basically make fun of him for a lot of things, and he, for some reason, takes it. So that worked out well, but we've, you know, we enjoy doing Purdue baseball and try to make it fun and entertaining, and it's good when Purdue's winning, and they're winning this year, so it's been nice.
That's for sure. Yeah, it's been fun to watch Purdue baseball this year. Drew, I'm the younger brother, too, so I feel your pain.
Yeah, sure. We got one younger, so I don't take all of the brunt of it. There's still a cushion beneath it. Can take more of it.
So that's awesome. You guys kind of touched on it a little bit, your postgraduate careers, starting as a probation officer. You mentioned all the things you did. Mm-hmm. Now back, kind of talk about what you guys are doing now. You mentioned doing window replacement.
Yep.
How about you, Kyle?
I'm a real estate agent here in town. I transitioned into that in 2018. So following in the footsteps of my mom, who was a realtor in town for 30 years before she retired a few years ago. And really, I've enjoyed that transition. Yeah. It has... I like it, and then also it provides me a little bit more time to delve into baseball and things like that still, and do the morning show when we were doing that and things like that. But my primary gig is helping people buy and sell real estate, and it's been a lot of fun.
Awesome.
I think my fourth or fifth year now, so it's been great.
Sounds pretty flexible too to be able to do this baseball thing on the side, right?
And the younger brother, who's not here, also is a realtor, so I occasionally lean on him if I have to be at the ballpark. But the day job is calling my name too, so that's been a big help.
That's awesome. Well, a free plug if you're looking for a home up
there. You go.
There you go. Call Kyle, and if you're looking for windows in Indianapolis or the West Lafayette,
there you go.
Right?
Or anywhere, he'll go anywhere. Okay.
There
windows.
There we go. Awesome. Let's talk about your roles with Purdue baseball, being the voices of baseball. What you guys do.
I'm the color commentator, so Kyle will tell you he'll handle the play-by-play duties. So I do all the home games. Occasionally I'll venture out on the road. I'm going to Iowa next week, and I'll actually be doing the play-by-play there, but that's very rare, maybe once or twice a year. And again, started in 2008, so been doing it for a long time, and you know, you touched on that flexibility. I've been thankful that my you know, job and career has given me that flexibility to be here. You know, when they want me to be here, and it's a blast. I mean, I sit here and watch baseball. I've watched more baseball than you know, most anybody I'm friends with or associate with, and you know, it's a great part of my life, and I enjoy it.
Yeah, not a bad gig to be out here at the baseball field.
Yeah, so I do play-by-play and have since 2004. Did a little bit of high school sports before that, but I hadn't done baseball until I started doing Purdue baseball. I've always loved baseball. I like the sport. I like sort of the strategy and everything that's involved and how, you know, one little pitch, one little play can make a huge difference. It's been great to follow Purdue, obviously. I mean, they've had some great seasons over the years. 2012 obviously stands out, and 2018 as well, both NCAA tournament teams. Rob Blackman takes a couple of games from me a year just to make sure that maybe I can spend a little bit of time with the family at home. So Rob's done that for a number of seasons now, and sort of as his schedule has changed with men's basketball, and he does a little bit of IndyCar stuff, you know, he's taken a little bit of a step back from Purdue baseball, but still gets in a handful of games. And Drew goes on the road once a year and does some play-by-play. So we've got a team of a few people that rotate in occasionally when we've got some scheduling issues, because it is hard to do 56 games in a season. But I love the travel. I love being on the road. Texas that first weekend was fun.
Yeah.
It's nice to go on the road trips to the Big Ten schools, and I'd like to think it keeps me a little bit younger because I get to hang out with a bunch of guys who actually can play the game. So it's a lot of fun.
That's awesome. And I love that you guys do the radio thing, and that's available on the streaming online, because, you know, living down in Indy and not getting to come to the games like I'd like to,
right,
it's fun getting to listen to you guys on the radio and just kind of follow along the game as from that standpoint. So thank you guys for doing that. You guys are doing an awesome job.
We try to make it, you know, both informative about baseball, but I think we, you know, not to toot our horn, I think we try to make it a little bit entertaining also, just with some other stuff that we've done, especially some funny things during the more lean years that we've tried to make it entertaining. One season we were trying to pick which came first, the player's walk-up song or the player's birthday.
That was a good game.
We did that a few
and then
times.
The fun facts that aren't even true.
Yeah, we started doing alternative facts.
Before
it was cool back in the day. So we've done that occasionally during some lean times.
Awesome.
What do we call it?
Fun facts that aren't even true.
Yeah, and that's turned out pretty.
That's awesome.
Fun.
And you guys also host a baseball podcast as well, right?
Yeah, we started that 4 years ago.
Yeah.
Just we felt like there was a podcast were becoming so popular, and we just felt like there was a lack of coverage of Big Ten baseball, and it was becoming more popular in the area, and we wanted to help grow that throughout the Midwest and the area, and so we record one a week, and we've been very fortunate enough that all the Big Ten coaches have been very very accommodating with their schedules as we have them as a guest every week, and I think it's been successful.
The only coach we've never gotten was Darren Erstad, and we won't get him because he's not coaching anymore.
Yeah.
So everyone else we've gotten on the show, I think. I think that's right.
Yeah.
So, we've gotten a lot of help from SIDs, and it's been popular. I mean, I think that there was a craving for more Big Ten baseball coverage.
Yeah.
It's a little bit of a niche, I think, still, but, we've had a pretty good following on it, and we've enjoyed doing it, too. It takes maybe more time at times than it needs to, because we have to compile some stats every week that takes couple hours that we prefer maybe to have somebody else do for us. If anybody has an intern they want to send our way, compile big
stats.
We need a
good stats
person.
Yeah, yeah,
we need a good stats person.
And is it a weekly podcast?
Yeah,
during the season.
Okay,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Yep. And just going back to the broadcasting part of it, I don't want to kind of put you on the spot here, but maybe one comes to mind either from this season or previous years you've done this. Is there a call that you've made that just stands out that, oh, man, that was awesome to be able to call that moment?
Well, even just a couple years ago, Mason Gavre hit a home run. Purdue trailed Rutgers 4-0 in the ninth. I think Purdue ends up tying the game in the ninth, and then he came up with a couple of runners on and hit a 3-run home run over the left field fence that was a good call. It was just so improbable. Mm-hmm. The game was over, basically. I mean, it felt like it was over. And, that was a somewhat, I don't want to say meaningless game, but it, wasn't a big moment. It wasn't a championship or something, but just a sort of improbable comeback. I mean, obviously there's the championship, years and 2012 and 2018, winning the regular season there. And, Rob actually was in Columbus for the tournament that year, 2000, for the Big Ten tournament. Mm-hmm. So he called the the fight at the end of the Indiana-Purdue game, which had to be a challenging call, but I'm sure one that was memorable for him. You know, both of us then, Rob and I both went to 2018, the NCAA regional, which was great. Drew and I were together in the middle of the night at the NCAA regional in 2012, which was, you know, an experience in itself because as people might know, that Kentucky-Kent State game, which was the first game of the 2012 regional in Gary, our beautiful park here was not yet finished, unfortunately. It was like partly done in 2012, so Purdue had to play up in Gary at the Steelyard, and that we had a huge turnout of alums and Purdue fans. I mean, there were thousands of people there, and unfortunately, everybody had to wait till 11:30 at night because the Kent State-Kentucky game went to 21 innings.
Wow.
And so that, you know, is a memory in itself. Purdue beat Valparaiso in that game. I don't know when it ended. It probably was 2 o'clock a.m. Eastern time or something crazy. But that certainly is one that sticks out.
Yeah, similar for me, you know, that 2012 season, that was the first going to Gary. And unfortunately, we had to go somewhere, you know, because the field wasn't done here, Alexander Field. So it was a home series in Gary, but since it was a home series, I was able to go on that trip. And so that was my first true like road trip with the team. And Purdue fans traveled so well to Gary, and the place was packed. It was just such a great place to be and an atmosphere to be in.
Yeah.
And then the 2018 season, you know, that was such a cool season because the team sort of rallied around Landon Griffith and, you know, sort of mediocre through the year, but then all of a sudden, you know, towards the end of the year, they rolled off, what, like 18 out of 19 wins or something like that. And it was just such a fun time to see that team grow and be coached so well by Coach Waskowski and make it to that tournament when nobody really expected them to. It was a fun season.
Landon was a young fan who was battling some health issues who came to the ballpark, I think, to the Indiana game that year,
yes,
if that memory serves.
Yep.
And Purdue really rallied around him, and I think, you know, both were beneficial to each other. So, you know, it made for a good story, and I think a good story both for Landon and for Purdue.
Yeah,
that's awesome, man. Plenty of great moments this year, too. Off to a great start this season. And you got to call quite a few walk-offs this year, too.
Yeah, there have been 6 walk-offs, including just a few days ago against Valparaiso. So, yeah, Purdue got off to a great start. You know, there was a little bit of a lull. You know, as there is in a 56-game season, I think, you know, it's hard to play really well for 50-plus games in a year. But hopefully here down the stretch, and it looks like they've played a little bit better here recently. So hopefully down the stretch they'll get rolling and get back to the Big Ten tournament. I think that should be Purdue's goal probably every year, get in the Big Ten tournament. And then, you know, try to put yourself in position to get in the NCAA regional. I don't know if an NCAA regional is in their future for this year. Probably not, unless they would really do something down the stretch and maybe at this point even win the Big Ten tournament. But certainly it's been an exciting season.
Yeah, for sure. It's been fun just in the last couple of years getting to know Coach Goff and what a great guy he is. He's an easy guy to root for, and it's fun to get behind him in a squad and just how, you know, optimistic he is. And just,
well, he plays a good style of baseball.
Yeah.
Too. I mean,
it's fun.
At the very least, you know, they're exciting to watch. They run. They hit the ball. You know, the pitching is – been a little thin this year, and a lot of that is due to youth and maybe more than that, injuries. But certainly they play a great style. I mean, they, you know, what are they? They got the big sign inside there, the fastest show on dirt or whatever the gigantic sign is inside the clubhouse. And it's true. I mean, they run around.
Yeah. Did you guys grow up playing baseball, loving baseball?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah.
That sums it up right there. No, we both played throughout. You know, Kyle.
Don't let him be modest. He's better than me. He was always better than me.
Kyle being older than me. My favorite experiences growing up playing baseball were, you know, Kyle being older than me when he got to the certain age where he could turn around and then coach some of my teams.
when I couldn't play anymore.
Yeah, when he couldn't. I was trying to be honest. But he would turn around and then therefore coach, you know, my 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, you know, sort of age groups with my dad. And so him being there, you know, with me and helping me out really helped me, you know, propel myself to be able to play in high school. And, I it's by far my favorite sport. I love playing. Coach Goff, as you know, has us out here to have batting practice every year in the fall. And I look forward to it every year. Once it's over, I look forward to the next year. I'm thinking about it right now, and it's just a blast. It's
He's going to be on the road in Iowa, and Goff always tries to get me on Thursday nights when we practice on the road to take BP, and I usually – find myself in the bathroom or somewhere not near the field so I don't have to do it.
I will not be finding myself
Drew
in the bathroom.
Drew will probably actually want to take BP because he can actually, you know.
I'm going to have my batting gloves on.
Hit the ball. Going.
Yeah, I got to do that for the first time this last fall. That was an absolute blast. I think I pulled a muscle or hurt myself, but it was still it was worth it. It was so much fun.
Totally worth it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Well, what does Purdue mean to you guys?
Well, I mean, to me, it's I enjoy, you know, I've lived here my entire life. I enjoy having something that can sort of bring the community all together. You know, we all have a common goal, I feel like, you know, in the community, whether it's, you know, baseball or whether it's going to the Rose Bowl or whether it's, you know, going to a Final Four. I think everybody in the community can rally around each other. And I think that that's what I like about living in West Lafayette. And that's what I like about Purdue.
You know, it's been a little bit different for me because I spent 15 years and still do write for a website called Saturday Tradition, do a little bit of, you know, Purdue commentary. So for me, I've been a neutral observer a little bit at times during my career. So less of a fan at times. So, you know, baseball provides me a little bit of better ability, as you can see by, you know, wearing the Purdue shirt and, you know, getting paid by Purdue and being here because it's Purdue. Provides me that opportunity in this setting to be a fan, which is, I think, a nice thing for me that I don't always get to do that. In fact, I had not sat in the stands at Ross-Ade Stadium until, well, my first game in Ross-Ade Stadium since 2003, I think, was during the COVID year when Drew and I got a couple of tickets and we sat with 500 other people in the rain for the Northwestern game. That was my first game back in Ross-Ade, like in the stands, like not in the press box, in, you know, 18 years or whatever. And then we actually sat in the stands like with actual people last year, and that was the first time for me that I had been, you know, in the stands. But, you know, Purdue, you know, when I was a student, I worked at the Exponent, I worked at the NPR station on campus, and for me, that was my education and sort of my jump start into being able to do some of the stuff that I like to do, both as a writer and then as a radio guy. And, you know, I love doing radio. I loved when we had the morning show. It was fun. We gave each other a hard time, but I thought, you know, we're entertaining and informative. And, you know, we started, were able to carry that into baseball as well, and it's been a good time.
Yeah, that's awesome. And you guys both married with kids now as well. Talk about
us. Both have twins.
Yeah. We'll talk about that. Your twins are older. I know that. And so, you know, when you find out you're getting twins, talk about making that call and saying, hey, we're having twins too. And
Well, for me, it was neat because, you know, him, Kyle being older and, you know, he keeps talking about how much he razzes me all the time. You know, I had twins first, you know, 4 years before him. Yeah. So I could see him go through the process and laugh at some things that he was doing or not expecting or underestimating about having twins. And it's like, man, you have a lot to learn. And I'm here to teach you. I can help you with this. But it's been great. I mean, twins are a handful, obviously. But I don't know it any other way. I had twins and two and done. And they're six now. So each year goes by, they get a little bit more independent, a little bit more easier to take care of. I you know, they're both girls, so it might go the other direction here eventually for a little while. But yeah, it's been fantastic.
Yeah, Drew's wife, Leslie, is a Purdue grad. My wife, Erin, is also
with Western Kentucky.
You know that. Oh, Western Kentucky.
She works at Purdue.
She works at Purdue.
She works at Purdue.
Boy, that was fun. My wife is a Purdue grad and went to UND, but never mind. I'm trying to make a recovery here. Not sure where I was going. But yeah, twins. I don't know if I called him and told him or just let him find out. I'm not really sure. but yeah, it's sort of funny that we both have that
is cool.
Experience. Yeah. So, and I'm following him, I guess, as he said.
And just how awesome is that you guys get to live in the community that you grew up in and be around Purdue and get to let your kids kind of experience that at a young age?
Yeah, I mean, I want my, you know, I want my kids to grow up, you know, similar to how I did. And I know when I graduated from high school, there wasn't really any question about it. I was going to Purdue, you know, and I want, you know, my kids to have that same feeling that it's here and it's a great school and you're going to get a great education and you're going to have a great time, even though parents are nearby. And, you know, I think that that they'll just enjoy that experience with, you know, having Purdue around their entire time, just like I did.
Yeah, yeah. I have an older daughter too, who I think is looking in this direction. Maybe she's 14. I got that right. At least get something occasionally, you know, the two twins obviously are not even two yet, but clearly this will be an option. I mean, my wife and I won't, as far as I could tell, won't ever leave town. Both our parents live here. Siblings are either here or close to here for both of us. So, you know, we'll be around for a while, I would suspect.
Yeah. Awesome. And as we're kind of wrapping up, anything else you guys want to add?
I would just like to add that I do know what Leslie's history is.
You're going to hear about that on Twitter later.
She's going to grave mistake.
Yeah.
But I'm going to take one on the chin on Twitter, I'm sure.
I think the only thing, I love what I do. This is, yeah. I get paid to watch baseball.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, growing up, if I told you in my late 30s I was going to get paid to watch baseball, I would have told you, whoa, that's a pretty good life, you know? So I get paid to watch baseball, and it's been a blast, and I hope to continue doing it for a long time.
He owes that to me, by the way. I took a gigantic leap. Like, he had no radio background. He had played, but he had no, like, actual radio. I was just like, I think the first game I was like...
I was so bad those first few games. So bad.
You were not great. You've gotten a lot better. In fact, sometimes when I listen to him, our voices are very similar. When I listen to you do play-by-play, and I'm like, it's hard, like, not to be like, how is that not me doing that right now? Because it sounds like me. I mean, even the sort of the cadence and stuff, and so that has sort of made it strange. I mean, I'll listen when you're at Iowa next week and be like, what? I don't understand how I'm not the one there, because it sounds like I'm the one there.
Twilight Zone.
That's awesome. Well, and I want to give you guys a chance again to plug the baseball podcast. What's it called, and where can people find it?
The Big Baseball Podcast. You can find it on anywhere you stream podcasts. We release them mid Tuesday mornings, and then they're available all week, so you can download it whenever you want throughout the week. But usually around 11 o'clock in the morning on Tuesdays is when those are released.
Awesome. We even argue about that, because he wants to do them on Wednesdays. And I want to get them done on Tuesday.
Wednesday makes way more sense.
That's awesome. Guys, it's been so great having you guys on the podcast and doing this special edition at Alexander Field. Also should add, Drew's got the coolest beard of any guest I've ever had on the podcast as well. So that's pretty awesome. And I also want to give a special thanks to our Fox 59 CBS4 videographer, Corbin Millard, who made the trip up here to help record this episode. So special thanks to Corbin for doing that. Gentlemen, thanks again for joining the Full Steam Ahead podcast.
Thank you.
Awesome. Boiler up.